Thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation, blessed with victory and peace. May the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must, for our cause it is just, and this be our motto: in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Please be seated. As I said, we're honored this year to have the Cupertino Middle School Honors Band providing the band music for us under the direction of Laurel Verissimo. And we have beautiful, beautiful choral music, a beautiful soloist this year, Kathleen Finniger, who will be singing during the program again. So thank you both for being here. And it reminds me how very special our Veterans Memorial and our Veterans Day ceremony are in many, many, many ways, including the sunshine that wasn't supposed to shine today. Because all of our school students, all of our young people have been involved since the very beginning. In addition to the band today, you may have noticed a lot of our high school students from our local high schools are here. They also have cards that they're passing out to veterans because they're all doing programs at their school, reaching out to veterans, trying to write biographies, trying to provide opportunities for young people and our military veterans to sit down one-on-one, and our Cupertino Rotary has taken a lead in this, one-on-one and talking to each other. And I will tell you, a year ago, I was at one of the breakfasts where they did this, and there's a picture, if you just in your mind, close your eyes for a minute, and I will tell you, there's this picture of this World War II veteran in his full uniform, proud of his uniform, spent most of the morning, we did a breakfast for them, and a young student from Monta Vista High School who had purple hair and so many rings in her face and ears, I couldn't count them, and they just fell in love with each other. They really enjoyed learning about each other's lives. They both wanted to go home and introduce the other one to their families. And so if you see any of the young people here today, all of our schools, all 25 of our elementary and middle schools and all 5 of our high schools have purchased pavers. Their message is in the pavers. And they've taken an interest every year they've been here to help us honor veterans and active duty military. So I think that's one of the things that I'm most proud about that has come about because of this memorial. I'm not going to spend a lot of time today telling you how it started. I will introduce Donna Axelson, who's sitting up front here with me, and her husband Corky, who are the parents of Matthew Axelson, the Navy SEAL closest to me and our sculptor. His death in 2005 is what inspired the family, myself, the city council, and a community to come together to build a memorial that honors our veterans, our active duty military, and we have a wall over here for our first responders. So you'll notice today that the fire department and the sheriff's department have been an integral part of the building and the annual ceremony. Every year they're here to support us and to pay tribute to our veterans, to our active duty military, and we include our first responders, including our city employees in that. I would like to introduce our city council and our mayor who are here with us today. I will tell you they come every year. They have since we dedicated this in 2007. Our mayor this year is Orrin Mahoney. Orrin will be speaking to you a little bit later. Rod Sinks, Mark Santoro, Barry Chang, and our former mayor, I know that that Patrick Kwok is here somewhere because I saw him earlier and back here, and Patrick has been here since the beginning too. It's always very nice to see them come out every year to help us celebrate. One more person I want to introduce, and then I promise I won't do any more, but Jim Black is the project manager. He's done this for free since we first asked him, and he is here today along with his wife, Barbara. Barbara will be carrying one of the bouquets to the sculpture in the middle of our program. I asked her to do that this year because she has a paver here. Her family has been active in the military since the American Revolution. And I thought since we are honoring women in the military going all the way back to the American Revolution, it would be appropriate to have someone represent them. And Barbara will be doing that today. Thank you, Barbara. Kathleen Ellett brings the coordinates with all of our retirement communities every year, and you will see a lot of our retirees, especially our World War II veterans who are here today, are here because of the efforts of Kathleen. And I would like to ask our World War II veterans, just because I think they're so very special to us, I think we all realize that, to either stand up, wave, shout, raise your hand, so we can give a special thank you to all of you. Thank you. Now, if all our other veterans would stand up, and our active duty military that happened to be in the audience, so we can say thank you to the rest of you. Thank you for all you do, for all you continue to do, so that we can all be here on a beautiful day like this, enjoying our community. And that reminds me, one of the things I thought about today as I was waiting for people were showing up, the fire department with their beautiful, beautiful ladder trucks and their flag. They don't do that for everyone, folks. That's special for us. And it's been a part of our ceremony since 2007. The sheriff showed up and they brought as many female deputies today as they could find available, and they're here to honor women in the military also. It dawned on me that this ceremony, the beginning when people start to arrive, when the parents all came and brought their students and brought their instruments, and people just come from all over. We never know how many are going to be here. We never know how long they're going to stay, where they come from, but they just arrive. And the community is here because they want to be. The fire and sheriff, the city is here because they want to be. We're all here because we want to be, as well as the veterans. And to me, that's what community is all about. So a lot of people talk about community. You hear it all the time. this is what community is all about. Look around you. Absorb the feelings that you have here today and the way you will walk away. And I guarantee you, this is what a real community feels like. Having said that, I'm going to invite Captain Joe Veramontes. Captain Veramontes and I met back in 1990. He was the captain on call the night my husband died. That's how far we go back. He came out, and amongst all the confusion, it was a sudden death. I was looking for my 8-year-old son, and he was sitting on the corner on the curb with this honking big firefighter's arm around him. And I was able to take care of what I needed to take care of because I felt so secure in that. And Joe and I have just run into each other over the years in various ways. He's been here every year for us, starting us off with all the right words. So please welcome retired Captain Joe Veramontes.
'90. I can't even remember that far back. I remember that day, though. I remember that day. Also, about 7 years ago, we started honoring the veterans. We started coming out here and honoring all those who have served. And it's been great. The last 7 years has just been outstanding. We've talked about the weather, and we've talked about how everything just comes together. And every time I come up here, I try and think of a word. It's like, God, give me something of inspiration. Give me a word. Give me a phrase. Give me some idea. And over the last 7 years, it's been varied. But this year, the idea that God has put on my heart is service. It's service. And it reminds me of a story from the Bible. It's about a guy that he's walking down the street, and he all of a sudden gets overtaken with some robbers. They beat him up. They work him over. Pretty much leave him for dead. And he's laying there on the side of the road. And then there's two other fellows that are kind of esteemed in the community. And when they see this individual who's beaten down and bloody and just off to the side, they see that individual. They cross over the street, walk down, and then go back to the side that they are walking on to completely overlook this fellow that's in need. And then, of course, there's another guy that comes up, and he's not as esteemed in the community. In fact, he's just a commoner, but he has a donkey, and he has a little bit of money. And what happens is this less esteemed person goes up to that individual, picks him up, bandages him up, puts him on his donkey, and takes him to a hotel, an inn. And he said to the owner, he said, take care of this guy. He's in need. Take care of him. And when I come back tomorrow, if you need additional money, I'll take care of the cost. Just take care of this fellow. And when I think about that story, I think about service. The story, as some of you know, is the Good Samaritan. But really, it's about an individual who serves, sees a need, and serves. There's people in the community that haven't served in the armed forces, haven't served in the fire department or police department. But there's men and women here who have not worn the uniform, and they serve. There's people behind me, men and women in the police department and fire department. They serve. And of course, there's people seated right before me who have served. They've served our country. Really, ultimately, they've served us. And I want to say thank you for that, for the service that you have provided for all of us. I want to say thank you. You're that guy that helped that individual, and you're the one that has served us and continues to serve us. Thank you very much. Let's talk to God. Lord God, we thank you again so much for this time to come together. We thank you for all of the servants who are here today. Whether they wear a uniform or not, it almost doesn't matter, Lord God. We know that there's people that have a pure heart that want to serve. We know there's individuals here like I said, that haven't worn a uniform, but they're willing to serve. We know there's responders, and they serve. And we know there's people that have served in the armed forces and have served for us so that we can live here and we can enjoy life. I thank you for the servants that are here today. I pray for this service right now that as we come together, that your hands would be on us and that we would look to you and know it's because of you and the hearts that you've given us that we can even be here today. For we ask this in your holy name. Everybody said, amen. Thank you.
Do a lot of this with the microphone today. I'm going to ask our mayor. I'm very proud to introduce Mayor Orem Mahoney. I've known him for a very long time. I've served with him, and I've partnered with him on many things, and he's been a supporter and a strong advocate for what we do here today. Please welcome Mayor Orem Mahoney.
Thanks, Sandy, and thank all of you for coming out today. We have a standing room only crowd, which is great. But we're here for one purpose, really, and that's remembering and thanking. And Captain Veramana used the word service. I have a different word that I want to talk about today, and that's sacrifice. What we're really talking about here, everybody that serves in the military really sacrifices for their country and for the rest of us. Sometimes that sacrifice is relatively small, and I use that term relatively because it's still significant. They may sacrifice a career where they start later in starting their career because they're serving in the military. They may sacrifice starting a family, or if they have a family, they sacrifice seeing their kids grow up and change day by day and week to week, which I'm experiencing. I've got local grandchildren now, and I see how important that is to just participate in that on a daily and weekly basis. And, of course, those of them that have gone off and experienced combat make a much more serious sacrifice. They come back with physical, emotional, and mental scars. And damage that causes them to sacrifice what we consider a normal life for the rest of their lives. And then finally, as we have people inscribed on the wall here, make the ultimate sacrifice, giving up their lives for their country and again for the rest of us. So what can we do? Our small part is being here. You know, as Sandy pointed out, the city council participated in this memorial, but I use the term participated. It was driven, funded, program managed, and executed by a group of volunteers in the community. Like many things in Cupertino, the government was there to facilitate in a small way. Was it worth it to do it? Absolutely. If you come here, especially during a festival or any nice day, and see people walking through here, looking at reading the inscriptions, reading the stories, especially the young people, some of which are here around us today. That's really important for all of us. So for those of you that came out and for those people that helped put this together, all I can say is a sincere thank you. Thank you.
Every year we have 2 to 3 speakers. This year we actually have 4. Two of them will be speaking together. But I always ask our first speaker to address Veterans Day in general, a little bit about why are we here? What is this all about? And I have somebody very special that's agreed to do that this year, Major General Robert Ostenberg. He's been here, I think, for the last 3 years. Maybe more, because I think he said he was standing in the back on our inaugural, and I didn't know him at that time. Last year, I asked him if he would come back and speak, and he agreed. So let me tell you a little bit about Major General Ostenberg. a native of Scopes Bluff, Nebraska. Major General Ostenberg graduated from Principia College with a BA in economics in 1969 and began his military career as an enlisted soldier. He attended the Infantry Officers Candidate School and was commissioned a second lieutenant in September of 1970. He served in Vietnam from 1971 to 1972 as a platoon leader with the 1st Battalion, 6th Infantry, and with the 1st Regiment, 1st Cavalry, of the 23rd Infantry Division. Major General Ostenberg served in every leadership position from platoon to division level command. From July 2005 through October 2008, Major General Ostenberg served as Director, Reserve Forces, with additional duty as one of five domestic attack assessors, North American Aerospace Defense Command, and the United States Northern Command at Peterson Air Force Base in Colorado. Major General Ostenberg's awards and decorations include the Distinguished Service Medal, the Defense Superior Service Medal, the Legion of Merit with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Bronze Star with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Purple Heart, the Meritorious Service Medal with Silver and Bronze Oak Leaf Clusters, the Air Medal with Numeral 2, the Combat Infantry Badge, and the Parachutist Badge. His military education includes Airborne School, Jungle Operations, Armor Officer Basic and Advanced Courses, the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College, and the United States Army War College. I am absolutely pleased that he would come today to spend some time with us and speak with us. Please join me in welcoming Major General Ostenberg.
Does that work? Okay. Well, it's a real honor for me to be here today, and ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests and veterans, and if you don't fall in that category, go to the distinguished guests part or the veterans there. They probably include most of you here today. On this day, in this month, at this hour, America pauses to honor every service member that has ever worn the military uniform in the service of our nation. We honor 21 million living veterans today, and we cherish the memories of those who are no longer with us. Everybody has to have a quote from somebody, so I've chosen one that I think applies to this particular day, and I have a modification at the end of it, if you'll allow that. President John F. Kennedy once said, "A nation reveals itself not only by the men it produces, but also by the men it honors and the men it remembers." I would like to have an addition to that, thought, and that's to include women, who are very prevalent in this World War II section over here and from all the other wars and conflicts that we fought. And I'll talk about one of those a little bit later on. My father served as an Army Air Corps pilot in World War II. If it had wings, he flew it. First, in flying from England down into the combat zone in Africa. And later on, when that was settling down, they transferred him to the China campaign, where he flew the hump in Burma. My wife's grandfather served in World War I and World War II. Her father is a Marine and served in World War II in the Pacific. She had two uncles who served in Korea. From them and from all Americans that had that service, we owe them a great debt of gratitude. These veterans fulfilled their destiny, and we owe them a special debt for that reason, and for being our example in today's Army today, still. Though with each passing day, their shadow grows from that generation longer, they are still examples to us all. There are lots, and I know you've already said this once, but there are lots of World War II veterans here today. And would you once again raise your hand or please stand to be recognized? Now, would the veterans from the Korean War stand and be recognized? Thank you for your service. Military service, when you served, was respected. The military was respected. And duty to country was also recognized and respected. Now we move to my generation, the 1960s, and Vietnam. With protests, some peaceful, many not so, America was deeply divided by reactions to the counterculture agendas and to the war itself. Vietnam was not a popular war, and those who served were not held, as I said, in high regard. Over 9 million Americans served during the Vietnam era. 2.7 million of those actually went to Vietnam or to the shores off of Vietnam. My older brother served 3 tours in Vietnam and was a great influence for me volunteering to go after he came home. I think the first time he probably didn't volunteer, but the other two he did. So he counts in this next statistic that I'd like to share with you. 2/3 of those who served in the Vietnam theater were volunteers. 75% of those who were killed in action were volunteers. There were 58,267 U.S. dead that are currently displayed on the Vietnam Wall in Washington, D.C. Among their names are those of some of my soldiers that served in Vietnam. But the youngest soldier, not one of mine, but on the wall, was only 15 years old, Private First Class Dan Bullock. There are 31 sets of brothers. There are 3 sets of father and son. The first one officially recognized as being killed in Vietnam, his son was also killed in 1965. There are also 8 women nurses listed on the Vietnam Wall. Today I remember my experiences in Vietnam as an infantry and a cavalry platoon leader as something that I'll always remember. Probably because I remember the soldiers I served with who I felt were honorable for their duty. I felt they were like brothers. And I remember that we felt that we wouldn't let each other down, we'd have each other's back, and we wouldn't quit till the mission was finished. These were great Americans, not appreciated, as I said, but they were appreciated in our band of brothers. Unlike earlier wars, we had no front lines. I got to work on a helicopter when we went out on missions. We'd stay 15, 20, 30 days and come back on a helicopter. I liked riding helicopters. It was good. We also didn't operate in large units. In the organization I was with, the Americal Division, we operated in platoon-sized elements, independently supported, and very rarely at full strength. But we were very effective in what we did. Last year began the rolling 50th year celebration honoring those who served in Vietnam, and it will continue until 2025, the year that we got out, 1975, 50 years, 2025. Today, Vietnam veterans are recognized with pride for their service, and as seen in this memorial right here, we have two individuals that I'll mention later, but they are recognized today as heroes, and we look at a Vietnam veteran memorial in Washington, D.C. that isn't too dissimilar from this, where we feel the same thing for those veterans today, and most Americans, as I say, do. There are a lot of communities that have dedicated to this idea for Vietnam and other wars. I was at San Jose's dedication of their Sons of San Jose Vietnam Memorial last spring, where they have a beautiful wall of granite etched with the 142 names of their fallen heroes. Campbell, California, and Los Gatos, California, I know particularly, are also doing something for the Vietnam veterans in honor of their service. Will all the Vietnam veterans who served during the Vietnam era please rise and take our appreciation for your service. After Vietnam, there was a serious downsizing. We're doing that today too, aren't we? Yeah, but there was a serious downsizing then. We went from 1969 an all-volunteer army of 1.5 million to 570,000 by 9/11/2001. However, in between those dates, and especially from 1982 to 2000, the military was busier than ever. We were involved in Lebanon, Grenada, Panama, the Gulf War, Somalia, Haiti, Bosnia, and Kosovo. Then on September 11, early in the morning, New York City, our world in the United States was turned upside down. For the first time, we were attacked successfully by a force or an invader from outside the United States. I was to be approved as a division level commander of the 63rd Regional Support Command down in Los Alamitos on the morning of September 11, 2001. Needless to say, that was delayed somewhat. But by the end of October, I had soldiers that were already serving in Afghanistan. I took over an organization of 14,000 soldiers that were located in three states, Arizona, California, and Nevada. By October 1st, when we inserted some special forces into the organization, I was asked for several people that had specialized skills, and they too accompanied the early troops going into Afghanistan to fight against the Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. My command, by the time I left in 2005, July, had deployed 9,500 of the 14,000 soldiers. They were deployed to Afghanistan, Iraq, and seven other countries in the Mideast or in Eastern Europe at that time. The military today is a force that we can all be proud of. Polls taken from 2003 to 2011 show that the military, along with our firefighters and police, and other protective services, are ranked from number 3 to number 7, depending on the poll you're looking at. That's a vast change from the Vietnam era, but it's a change that is the way it should be for the dedication and service that they give. In the Army, we have a set of values that I believe are shared by all other services and members serving today. They are loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, honor, integrity, and personal courage. Look again at this wonderful monument of the Guardians. Look at Matthew and James, two Navy SEALs who paid the ultimate price for the defense of their nation and for their beliefs. Their sacrifice was for defending freedom. Their sacrifice, like others that serve and that have been killed in service, are supported by family members and friends that I can say even back in Vietnam, my friends supported, even though they had beliefs that were contrary to my service. They supported that action. And today, your presence here shows that you support the military and those that have served, and like these two who gave their lives for our freedom. I'm remembering soldiers today too, and I'd like to share a few thoughts along those lines. These are from current conflicts. Paul T. Nakamura. He was a medic. He was in the 137th Medical Company from Fort Carson, Colorado. He had done over 100 missions rescuing and taking care of soldiers that were wounded, Marines that were wounded, and even some Air Force and Navy that were wounded. He was on the group of medics that went with the Special Operations Command to rescue the 507th Maintenance Company. Probably don't know who that is, but you might remember Jessica Lynch, who was a member of that company. Less than a month later, Paul Nakamura was killed after he had picked up a wounded soldier and an RPG came through the side of his medical van, and he sheltered the wounded soldier and gave his life. Cameron Sarno. I was in Kuwait on August 1st of 2003. He was with one of my transportation companies. I was really concerned about him, so I flew in there to talk to him about the fact that they had done 1.2 million missions when three other companies in the same battalion had only done a total of 1.2 million. And I thought it was just putting him in too much risk, and I'd like to spread the wealth with the other transportation companies and give them an opportunity to shine. When I talked to the company commander and with the leadership and the NCOs, they asked me to not intercede and change anything because they felt they had a great relationship from where they were driving in Kuwait all the way up through Mosul, Baghdad, and outlying towns and cities, and they wanted to keep doing what they were doing. By the time they left, they had driven on 94 vehicles, 2.1 million miles. Cameron Sarno, I was informed the next day, was killed as I was getting on a plane to head back to Afghanistan. You know, he asked me if he'd take a picture, if I could take a picture with him during that day. And I was a little hesitant, but I thought, well, what the heck? And we took a picture. And I found out when I went to the funeral in Hawaii that he had sent that picture home before he passed away. And he also sent thoughts to his parents, telling him how proud he was of what he was doing and the great help and the great advancing that he was doing for the people of Iraq. Kelly Bullar was a great NCO. He was attached to the 101st Airborne. They were on a mission outside of Mosul. He was on one of two helicopters that as they took off, they collided. All 17 on both helicopters were killed. Kelly Bullar was on loan to them because of his special tactics and technical skills. He left behind his wife, Kelly, and a son, Kyle, an infant. And lastly, Tina Teemay. Tina Teemay was with a transportation company that I had and in Iraq. And she must have been a little bit under 5 feet tall, might have weighed 80 pounds, and she drove the biggest vehicle the Army owned, and she was good at it. When she was on a convoy, she was killed near Cedar in Iraq on December 13th, 2004. She was from American Samoa, a population of 60,000. 42,000 of them have served in the United States military, two-thirds. I flew with her on her final flight home on New Year's Eve, and the airport where we arrived had over 2,000 people that met the plane to honor her return. My thoughts and prayers are with these soldiers and with their families every day. To those that are serving today, I think they are the best and the brightest we've ever had. That's not taking away from other generations. It's just that we've been volunteer since since 1969 in the Army. And in the other services, that's pretty volunteer anyway, but they know where they're going when they sign up today. And recruiting has not missed a recruiting quota since the year they had the 30,000 add-on back in the mid-2000s. I think we can be proud of your service, and we should be proud of those serving today in harm's way. And may God bless each and every one of those soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marine, and Coast Guardmen for the duty that they do today. And may God bless all of you that have served, and bless the United States Army and the other services, which we'll be speaking in a moment. But in particular, may God continue to bless the United States of America. Thank you very much.
Since this memorial is the direct response to a group of community members who came to a city council meeting back in 2005 and asked if they could put a plaque in Memorial Park or in the library honoring Matthew Axelson, who is the closest to me on this sculpture, who was the local man who grew up in Cupertino, went to our schools, whose mother taught in our schools, and as city council members are so wise, we were at that time, and we said, of course you can, but why don't you get a group of community members together and build a memorial to all veterans and active duty military, including Matthew. So when I stepped down out of office about 6 months later, I said in response to a question from the audience, what do you want to do next? I'd really like to be involved in the Veterans Memorial, and it didn't take Donna and Corky Axelson too long to make a phone call and ask me to join them. One of the smartest things I ever did, one of the things that I have received the most amazing gifts from, just the people that we've met here, just the very special things that have happened on this place and this wonderful memorial that we have. But every year we invite someone to come from Special Forces and speak a little bit about that particular aspect of the military, because that's where this started and because you're looking at this beautiful sculpture through the whole ceremony. This year we're very fortunate to have a Navy SEAL who flew up from LA to be with us today, Lieutenant Commander Kaj Larsen. Let me tell you a little bit about him. Lieutenant Commander Kaj Larsen, excuse me, is a U.S. Navy SEAL assigned to Special Operations Command Africa. He has done over 4 deployments in the global war on terror, leading teams of special operations personnel in missions overseas in the Middle East, Africa, Asia, and South America. Commander Larsen served on active duty from 2000 to 2005. He was in Bud's Class 237 with both Matthew Axelson and James Suh. After his active duty service, he attended graduate school and earned a master's degree in public policy from Harvard University. Lieutenant Commander Larsen used his pay from the service to help start the Mission Continues, one of the largest veterans organizations in the country today. He continues to serve as a SEAL attached to Naval Special Warfare Command. As a reserve officer, he was deployed to Africa 3 times over the past year. Please join me in welcoming Lieutenant Commander Larsen.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Sandy. Mayor Mahoney, Admiral Breckenridge, General Ostenberg, fellow veterans, fellow frogmen, Rick, John, I've seen a few of you in the audience today. members of the public, but most importantly, members of the Axelson, Donna, Corky, and members of the Sioux family, Claudia. It's an honor to be here with all of you today. 237 is a very significant number for me. It's the number of my SEAL training class. BUDS, Basic Underwater Demolition SEAL Training Class 237. Now, class number is a number that's ingrained into the mind of every SEAL. In my class, through coincidence, or what we called the hand of God at the time, we started our training class with 237 people. We were convinced that the symmetry of having 237 people starting in class 237 made us a special class, and that we were going to be the first BUDS class where nobody quit. The instructors in charge of our training also thought we were special. So special that on that very first day at 5 a.m. when they had us on the grinder, which is a place of legendary physical training sessions, they were screaming, they were shooting fire hoses at us, and they really made us feel quite special on that morning. We had five guys quit on the first day alone, and many more to follow after that. Our illusions of special being shattered, we'd enter into a seven-month-long process of survival. Now, BUDS is generally considered the hardest military training in the world. Hell Week, which is a week of no sleep, where you test the limits of human performance, is generally considered the hardest week of the hardest military training in the world. In Hell Week, they group you into boat crews according to size, with an officer in charge of most of the boat crews. On one end of the spectrum, you have the shortest guys, who we affectionately dub the Smurf crew. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have the taller guys. Because I was on the taller end of the spectrum, I was grouped in to a boat crew with Matt Axelson. We spent every day of Hell Week together. Matt would go on to be my communicator in advanced warfare qualification training. We would go to jump school together at Fort Benning, and we spent quite a significant amount of time together. But it was really in Hell Week that our bond was established. Perhaps it was preordained that Matt and I would be friends. We were both from Northern California. Matt went to Monta Vista, and I went to Harbor High School over the hill in Santa Cruz. And while we were rivals when it came to water polo, our Northern California pride made us instant allies when we were in BUDS. At the end of Hell Week, you have to complete this arduous 7-hour paddle around Coronado Island where the training is located. You have to remember at this time, you haven't slept for 5 days, you're extraordinarily cold, and you're all alone out there in the ocean or the bay, except for your boat crew. And I remember that sometime around 2 a.m., after the monotony of having been paddling for hours and hours and stroke after stroke, I fell asleep with a paddle in my hand, and I fell into the water and started to drift away. And I remember waking abruptly from the cold water, and there was Matt with his hand on my life jacket, and I was looking into those big blue axe eyes. And Matt, who was always calm and collected in any moment, no matter how pressure-filled the situation was, just looked at me and he said, "Sir, this is really no time for a nap." So believe it or not, after Hell Week, SEAL training actually becomes more difficult. And the second phase of training is called dive phase. And it's where you learn a traditional SEAL mission known as combat diving. And what's interesting about dive phase is that this phase of training is as mentally grueling as it is physically grueling. And many students actually end up washing out because they can't handle the academics associated with this phase of training. Now, one of those students that was on the bubble when it came to learning the dive physics and dive physiology was a really tough guy from Texas named Morgan. Now, physically, Morgan was in the upper tier echelon of our class. But academically, despite the fact that he was a smart guy, he was really struggling with dive physics. And he was one final test away from being dropped from training and having his dreams of being a SEAL shattered. I remember going back to the barracks one night after a very late combat dive and seeing another student tutoring Morgan in the noble gas equations. And he was helping him do things like memorize Boyle's Law and Archimedes' Principle and doing all of the math and physics and calculations associated with that for the test that was upcoming that Morgan had to pass. And just to put it in context, you have to remember, when you have a four-hour dive that ends in 2 a.m, then you still have to clean your gear and wash everything out and get back to the barracks and then wake up the next morning and do it all again. Every second of sleep becomes precious. You only get a couple hours, and you need every little bit to perform the next day. But then there was James, an enlisted guy, an enlisted man who had already earned his four-year degree from the University of Florida. I think James was a math major, if I remember correctly, so the academic part was fairly easy for him. And I saw him up night after night, tutoring Morgan, sacrificing his own sleep in order to help one of our guys get through. At that time, I didn't know it, but years later, my friend James would sacrifice himself to save Morgan's identical twin brother in Afghanistan. After 7 months of grueling training, our special class of 237 people graduated 26 individuals. As we walked across the grinder for the final time as students, James and Matt were standing at my side. They were two of the 26 originals from our class. We would go on to advanced warfare training together. We earned our tridents, the SEAL warfare qualification symbol, together. And then we went off to different SEAL teams. But we stayed in touch when I left active duty service for graduate school. On June 28th, 2005, I learned that James and Matt were killed in Kunar Province, Afghanistan. Axe was killed helping his platoon survive a firefight with Talib fighters. And James, who spent our entire class helping others get through, was killed trying to rescue Axe. In their final moments of service, both of my friends were still serving others. Matt and James, I miss you guys every day. When I finished graduate school in 2007, myself and another member of the class of 237 started an organization called The Mission Continues, in the spirit of service to others that Matt and James lived their lives by. In 2009, we created the James Sue Memorial Fellowship, and we paid for one veteran to continue his service out of uniform. What we realized, the genesis of the idea in 2007, is that there was over 1 million veterans that have served in Iraq and Afghanistan, and that there's a new generation of veterans that are coming home now. In this next 2 years, over 1 million veterans will transition out of service. And as I went around the country talking to veterans, asking them what they wanted to do, I received a bunch of different answers. Some said they wanted to coach. Some said they wanted to run for city council. Others wanted to teach in their local high school. What they were all saying, in their own words, was that they wanted to continue serving. So we started the Mission Continues. And at Mission Continues, we give fellowships to returning veterans to do 6-month fellowships in public service. We tell them that regardless of your injuries, regardless of your PTSD, regardless of whatever problems you may be struggling with, your country still needs you, and your service still matters. To date, we've given over 800 fellowships to veterans who are doing community service. Those are people like Matthew Trotter, who teaches equitherapy to autistic children. Sonia Menendez, who works with big brothers and big sisters. And Michael Paul, who teaches adaptive skiing to disabled athletes. These are veterans who continue to serve. Today, Team Rubicon, which is an organization that was started with a fellowship from our organization, Mission Continues. Their founder was one of our first fellows. Today, 15 members, veterans, are deploying with Team Rubicon to assist victims of the flood, of the typhoon that happened in the Philippines over this past week. Those veterans are using their military skills and they're repurposing them for good. They're proving the idea that the men and women who have survived the crucible of battle are coming home to rebuild this country, and that there is a new generation of veteran leaders who are continuing to serve their country. Today on Veterans Day, I think it's important to reflect on why this matters. There are many World War II veterans here in the audience today. And after World War II, an entire generation of veterans came back and rebuilt this country. Now, the general referred to it earlier, but after Vietnam, we had difficulty reintegrating veterans into civilian life. And I think it's safe to say that in some ways the country still deals with some of that failure today. The battle for this next generation of veterans is still up for grabs. We can be remembered as a generation that came back from war, struggled with issues of PTSD, cost the country billions of dollars in healthcare services, and failed to reintegrate successfully. That's one path. But we believe there's also another path. We believe at Mission Continues that we can be a generation of veterans who came back and rebuilt our communities, who volunteered, who ran for public office, who used all of those same skills that we learned in the military and used them to serve here at home again in our communities. At Mission Continues, we have service platoons of veterans popping up around the country, tackling issues like homelessness and poverty, and they're doing it with that same esprit de corps that they would a military mission. And I think this is fundamentally important for the direction and the future of the country. We, this next generation of veterans, are healing the wounds of war by serving others. And I invite you all, veterans and civilians alike, to join me on this journey. Matt and James wouldn't have it any other way. Thank you and hooyah.
This is the part in our program that we do every year. Those of you that have been with us, I know it's one where we are very grateful to both the Axelson and the Sa family that they are willing to share the stories of their loved ones and their personal grief to help us to better understand, to better value, and to better honor those in the military and those that have lost their lives in the military. So at this time, we will have our Marine escorts come forward one at a time and escort Claudia Sa, James' sister, and I think his niece, perhaps, maybe his nephew. And Barbara Black, who, as I said, is representing the history of the American military from from our very first beginnings to the present, and Donna Axelson, who, of course, is here for the Axelson family and for the Veterans Memorial Foundation. So, Jason, if we could start the music and if we could have our first Marine escort come forward.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, where I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. Gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness, this world we stumble through, all these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
Donna just reminded me of something. Claudia Suss' son, who you saw, is named Matthew James. He has two wonderful names. Very special. Every year, we also place a wreath at the Wall of Honor. The Wall of Honor behind us is dedicated to all those in our area, don't have to be from Cupertino, but in the area, who have died in the line of duty. Well, the pavers that you see before you on the Walk of Remembrance is for everyone and anyone You can purchase one at any time. The Wall of Honor is reserved for those names that gave the ultimate sacrifice. And so every year we have a beautiful wreath produced by Cupertino Florist that we place at the Wall of Honor. I would ask the our two deputies who are going to escort the wreath if they would get it at this time and bring it forward. And then I'm going to call the names of some of our women veterans to help escort it. And then I'm going to ask the rest of the women veterans who are in the audience to please join them, since we're doing something special this year for women in the military. So I'll call three or four names, if you'd come forward and join the wreath. Miriam Friedman. Vi Phelan. Pauline Bessler. And Carolyn Garrett. And I think one of them wasn't able to make it. As they escort the wreath, our wonderful soloist is going to sing The Wind Beneath My Wings. And please, any other women veterans that we have with us today or active military, please join them.
Fly higher than an eagle, 'cause you
Doesn't she have a beautiful voice? I don't know about you, but I was watching all the birds flying while she was singing that song. I've never seen so many seagulls in this park before. I don't know if you. Usually it's ducks and geese, but there are all kinds of seagulls circling over here. This year, the last few years, we've done something special for the last third of our program. In addition to honoring all veterans, we started with especially for World War II, and we have a memorial boulder for them behind us. And then we did something for the Vietnam veterans because we brought the Vietnam Wall up. And then we did the Korean veterans, and I realize that's out of sequence. Today, we'd like to do something special for women in the military. And on the back of your program is a chronology of some of the highlights of the history of women in the military, which you can read at another time. I'm not going to go through any of it because I know that our next speaker is going to touch on some of this. And so I would like to tell you a little bit about Vice Admiral Jody Breckenridge. We're just honored to have her with us today. Vice Admiral Jody Breckenridge retired in 2010 after serving 34 years in the United States Coast Guard. She's also our first Coast Guard speaker. Her last assignment was as Pacific Area Commander with responsibility for the Coast Guard's 11 mission areas throughout 73 million square miles of the Pacific and one of just 2 3-star operational commands for the service. Handpicked by the Commandant, Vice Admiral Breckenridge guided the largest transformation in modern history, restructuring the service, adopting a new business model for logistics, and realigning business practices. Under her leadership, the 11th Coast Guard District in Alameda recognized significant advances in drug interdiction, including record seizures and arrest of the head of the Arellano Felix drug cartel. Throughout her career, Vice Admiral Breckenridge served in a variety of operational and support billets, including Commander of the Maintenance and Logistic Command Pacific, Deputy Chief of Staff for the Coast Guard as the service transferred into the Department of Homeland Security, and Chief of Officer Candidate School, to cite a few. Since retiring, Vice Admiral Breckenridge continues to serve the military through board membership in organizations that support military members and their families. In addition, 2 of her 4 children are serving on active duty. Please join me in welcoming Admiral Breckenridge, and she will be introducing a second speaker.
Thank you so much, Sandy. Let's get this a little closer. Mayor Mahoney, members of the City Council, fellow veterans, active duty members, and distinguished guests, I am so honored to be here participating in this special ceremony on this special day in this very special place. First, I would like to thank our first responders who are here for participating in this ceremony, for supporting the efforts here, and for what they do each and every day for the community. I also want to thank the members of the Veterans Memorial Committee and your community for your efforts to remember and honor those who have served. This park you have created is a living testament to veterans and first responders. It is a special place where there is a palpable feeling of peace and reverence. You feel the stories and accomplishments of those you honor. Thank you for your remembrance, your commitment, and your reminder that the life and liberties we enjoy in this nation have been earned for us by those who wear the uniform. Today's program celebrates women in our services, but to give you some context for my comments and Master Chief Cales Jones, I would like to tell you a bit about your Coast Guard. The Coast Guard's roots are in the Revenue Cutter Service, founded by Alexander Hamilton on 4 August 1790, when he requisitioned 10 revenue cutters. As a maritime nation, the United States and its economy was dependent on protection of our maritime interests. The Revenue Cutter Service was created to do just that and to help collect tariffs to fund our new nation. In 1915, the Revenue Cutter Service and the U.S. Life Saving Service were merged, forming the Coast Guard. By statute, the Coast Guard is a military service and a branch of the armed services. In 1939, the service expanded to include the U.S. Lighthouse Service, and in 1942, the Bureau of Marine Inspection. Throughout its history, the Coast Guard has adapted while always staying true to its roots and values. As its responsibilities changed in response to the nation's needs, and as it moved from the Department of the Treasury to the newly formed Department of Transportation in 1967, and then to the Department of Homeland Security in 2003. The Coast Guard is roughly the size of the New York City Police Department, with international responsibilities across 11 mandated missions: ports, waterways, and coastal security, drug interdiction, aids to navigation, search and rescue, living marine resources, marine safety, defense readiness, migrant interdiction, marine environmental protection, ICE operations, and other law enforcement. The Coast Guard has served in every war and major engagement of our nation since its inception. And today's Coast Guard members stand semper paratus, always ready, responding daily here at home and abroad, protecting the maritime interests of our great nation. Now, for our comments on women in the military, I'll share my comments with Master Chief Cale Jones, who I'll introduce in the moment. I am going to speak to what I represent, the past. Master Chief Cale Jones, who is currently serving on active duty, will represent the present and the future. Women have answered the call of our nation to serve back to the days of the Revolutionary War. Women served as civilian nurses, cooks, laundresses, and saboteurs during the war. In 1776, when John Thomas joined the Army, his wife Hannah took over his job as keeper of Gurnet Point Light near Plymouth, Massachusetts. During the Revolutionary, Civil, and Mexican Wars, a small number of women served in combat by disguising themselves as men. Deborah Sampson Gammon of Plymouth enlisted under the name of her deceased brother and served for 17 months in the Continental Army. She was wounded twice and cut a musket ball out of her thigh so a doctor would not discover she was a woman. In 1804, she was granted a pension for her service. Not able to serve as a doctor, Dr. Mary Walker signed on as an Army nurse during the Civil War. Later, she was contracted as an assistant surgeon, becoming the first woman doctor to serve with the Army Medical Corps, and for her service was awarded the Medal of Honor. Women served as civilian nurses from the Revolutionary War until the early 1900s, when the nurse corps were established in the Army and the Navy, but women were still not commissioned in the regular corps. During World War I, nurses served in military hospitals stateside and overseas. More than 400 military nurses lost their lives, predominantly to the Spanish influenza. The rapid expansion of the armed forces produced a shortage of resource power, but a mass of administrative work. The Army hired women as civilians due to a legal restriction limiting enlistments to males, but the Navy, Coast Guard, and Marines decided to enlist women in the reserve for, quote, the best clerical assistance, end quote, and to release men for combat duty. Thousands of women applied, and the process was extremely selective for that opportunity to serve. Navy and Coast Guard reserve yeomen were known as yeomanettes, but while the term Marinettes was embraced by the women serving in others, it was not by the Marine Corps. The women were Marine Reserve female, and no other name was to be used. With the end of the war, the women reserves were mustered out. while Army and Navy nurse corps were significantly reduced. During World War II, 350,000 women served in the military, 74,000 as Army and Navy nurses. The remainder served in the women reserve component of their respective service. For the Coast Guard, this was our SPARS, from Semper Paratus Always Ready, our motto, one of whom is with us today. Hi, Vi. When established in 1942, only a handful of ratings were open to the SPARS, who came from all walks of life to answer the call of our nation. Many performed non-traditional jobs, learned new skills, and leveraged opportunities as the services utilized the talents these women brought to the workforce. For instance, in the summer of 1943, Lieutenant J.G. Vera Hammerschlag and a crew of enlisted SPARS were trained and took over the operation and maintenance of the LORAN system on the East Coast. LORAN stands for Long Range Aids to Navigation, which at the time was a brand new and highly classified system, and they operated out of Chatham, Massachusetts. By the end of the war, women, through their own talents, had spread from just a handful of ratings to 43 ratings. They had more than proven themselves. And the Coast Guard has named two cutters to recognize and honor the service and contributions of our SPARs: the U.S. Coast Guard Cutter SPAR, a buoy tender in Alaska, and last year we commissioned the U.S. Coast Guard Cutter Dorothy Stratton, which is homeported up in Alameda, California, in honor of the head of our SPARs during World War II. Now, one of the recruiting slogans for our SPARs was, "You can't be an admiral, but you can be the admiral's secretary." Well, we've come a long way. You know, I was talking to our three World War veterans who were announced and went up to help place the wreath. And typical of the enthusiasm with which they served and all that they brought to the workforce and to the war effort, one of them said, "You know, if they asked me today, I'd enlist all over again." In 1947, the Army and Navy Nurse Corps were established in the regular component with permanent commission grades, equal pay, and benefits. But from World War II to 1973, only a small number of persistent women served in the reserve, most inactive. In 1973, Congress passed a law ending the Women's Reserve as a separate entity and opening service in the regular component. In 1973, Coast Guard Officer Candidate School opened its doors to women, and Cape May, our boot camp, accepted the first regular women enlistees into integrated training in 1974. I attended Officer Candidate School in 1976, entering the sixth class with women. At that time, women could not be assigned to sea duty. But that changed the following year, and by 1978, for the Coast Guard, all career fields were open to women officers and enlisted, and have remained so. The combat exclusion policy did not apply to the Coast Guard, since the service was not part of the Department of Defense. I was privileged to serve with trailblazers in the Coast Guard and the other services. Women such as Vivian Cray, our first fixed-wing pilot, the first woman of any service to serve as military aide to the president and to carry the nuclear football, and the first woman to serve as a number two in a service. For the Coast Guard, that is the position of the vice commandant, which, unlike the other services, is a three-star and not a four-star position. Beverly Kelly was in the first group of women assigned to float in 1977 and the first to earn command to float in 1979, first woman to command one of our combatant cutters. Trish Stoley, in the first women of regular enlisted to attend boot camp, the first woman chief petty officer assigned to float, and the first woman master chief petty officer. She was my command master chief for 4 years, and as I traveled with her along the West Coast, you know, I found I was in awe of the number of people who had been Stoli trained or who she had reached out and touched in one way or another. One person truly can make a difference. And Kelly Mook, the antithesis of the stereotype of our rescue swimmers, which is essentially a power a builder, she became the first rescue swimmer, one of our most physically demanding ratings. And as a junior petty officer, was awarded the Aviation Medal. Kelly was a great performer and leader who went on to Officer Candidate School during the time that I was the school chief and became a Coast Guard pilot. These women come from very different backgrounds and parts of our nation, but like those who came before them, wanted to serve. Like those who came before them, they had a strong love of our nation, a sense of purpose, and a desire to be part of something bigger than themselves and to make a difference. They did not seek the limelight, but it did seek them, often putting them under the microscope. And whether fair or not, it was a reality. What strikes me, though, is that while regardless of uniform, women have served since the very inception of this great nation, we are just coming to the close of the first generation of those women who entered the modern services as members of the regular component. Our services are better for the presence of women. Many of the changes affected since 1973, attributed as women's issues, have really been programs and policies that improve the quality of life for all service members and for our service families. The burden of protecting our liberties and way of life is borne by a very small percentage of our population, a mere 1%. It is not the calling of all. It is a very different lifestyle and level of commitment. For those willing to live that lifestyle and commitment and desiring to serve, the changes affected in 1973 allow both men and women to pursue that passion and position the services to leverage the great talent of our nation to meet the daunting missions the American public requires of them. I am deeply honored to have served with those who wear the uniform of each of our services, and here to tell you, as the general so eloquently stated, that our nation is in very good hands. I'd now like to introduce you to Master Chief Lani-Cale Jones, who currently serves as the Command Master Chief of the Coast Guard's Pacific Area. Master Chief Cale Jones enlisted in the Coast Guard in 1987. She has served at virtually every kind of unit that the Coast Guard has, including being assigned to the Coast Guard cutter Polar Sea during its deployment to Antarctica. While on active duty, she has completed two master's programs, as well as a number of leadership programs. She has a number of distinguished awards, which you will see on her uniform, so I won't share them with you. But to give you a context for the position she holds in our service, you know, we have 1 4-star, 5 3-star positions, two of which are operational. We have an Atlantic commander and a Pacific commander. Lani is the Command Master Chief for the Pacific Area Commander and is the senior most female serving. She is the only female serving as an advisor to a 3-star in the Coast Guard. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce Master Chief Lani-Cale Jones.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. These are the words spoken a little over 50 years ago on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial by a gentleman named Dr. Martin Luther King. When I joined the United States Coast Guard in 1987, I had little appreciation, let alone knowledge, of where women were in the history of the military services. For my own military service, we were only 14 short years from 1973, when women were first allowed to serve alongside our brothers in arms in full-time active military service to their country. And as the Admiral mentioned, the Coast Guard was the first service to have a fully integrated recruit training. Today, we see a service where young women such as Seaman Brianna Wyatt and Petty Officer Third Class Bethina Menlo can look up and see themselves in a calling where women such as those mentioned by Vice Admiral Breckenridge and even the Vice Admiral herself ascended the ranks as admired and respected equals to their male teammates. These young women represent an inspired future. They dedicate themselves to hard work, motivation, and perseverance, all spawned in a deep yearning to that strong sense of purpose and desire to be part of something bigger than themselves that Vice Admiral Breckenridge spoke of. Myself, I joined the Coast Guard because as a young woman of 18 from that great seafaring state of Idaho, I was drawn to the missions of the Coast Guard, protecting our citizens from the perils of the sea, threats delivered upon our seas, and the seas themselves. It all was awe-inspiring then, and it is today. Over my 26 years on active duty service to you, I have personally benefited from the paths blazed by the achievements through hard work and barrier breaking of women like Master Chief Trish Stoley, Master Chief Diane Bucci, and Vice Admiral Breckenridge, who faced the challenges of being females in a male-dominated vocation without flinching. I've had the great privilege to serve in their footsteps and to experience the opportunities granted by the accomplishments of these truly remarkable ladies. My task is to honor these women by continuing to forge ahead and to leave footprints small enough for those who follow behind to create their own marks without false barriers and impediments. I'm equally privileged to serve alongside my many uniformed brothers and sisters in service to our nation, protecting our freedoms and ensuring our safety and security, knowing there's no place in the Coast Guard in which women cannot serve merely because of their gender. As I stand before you representing the 42,000 women and men of your United States Coast Guard, I take pride in knowing that women are choosing to enter our military branches and don the cloth of our great nation, seeing it as a viable profession. This is evidenced in the numbers entering our accession points. The Coast Guard Academy and recruit training seeing class bodies and company throughput wherein at least 25% or better were women. Roughly one-third of our throughput at recruit training just last year was women. These are smart, driven women, and it's heartwarming to see so many answer the call of their nation. And judging by the quality of those who are our future freedom defenders, I echo the Vice Admiral's message to you that your United States Coast Guard and our nation is in good hands. Actually, I'll go one step further and say they're in great hands. I have a dream where every woman who joins the United States military knows, can, and will reach the pinnacle. Ladies and gentlemen, my dream is poised to be realized. There is no glass ceiling in the United States military for anyone. And to honor those who have earned our liberties and way of life, I would like to challenge for each of us here today and back in our communities to increase the 25% of those 18 to 24 who qualify for military service today. Thank you, Sandy, Mayor Mahoney, and the City Council members and fellow veterans. Thank you for your time, for your service. Happy Veterans Day and Semper Paratus.
You know, one of the very special side effects of this ceremony every year is that it does open the eyes of many of our young people to a potential career in the military. It isn't something that they necessarily think about. Is that better? And I've had many of them, whether they're with the choir or with the bands or whatever, come up to me afterwards and say, you know, they never thought that that was a career opportunity that they should look into. And as I look at Joe Vermontez, I should broaden that, not just the military, but the fire service and the sheriff also. Those are very viable career opportunities for all of our young people. And so I think not only do we broaden their knowledge of all the wonderful, wonderful, special advantages they have in this country and in this community, but it gives them a chance to hear and look at the people who put their lives on the line to help provide them with those opportunities. And sometimes it's hard for us to share that with our children. So I think it's important that they're here. We love having them be a part of our ceremony, and I hope it does open their eyes to opportunities for career advancement. We're going to dedicate a memorial stone for women in the military, and it's behind me. We have sheriff deputies that have been protecting it through this ceremony. And I'm going to tell you what it says, and then I'm going to ask them to unveil it. And as they do that, we're going to have our soloist sing a beautiful song for us, Climb Every Mountain, which I thought was very appropriate for the careers of women, all of us. So this boulder, if you would like to uncover it for us, says, "Women in the military, we salute you, we honor you, defending freedom at home and abroad. God bless you all," and it has the emblems of each branch of our military service. Going to come to the end of our program, and I'm going to speak briefly, and the rest of the program is going to flow from one very emotional aspect to the other until we're through. I'm going to leave a couple flyers up here because people have asked me for them. One is the form for how you can purchase pavers, and there is a holder out here for it, but I'll put some up here. And also, Cupertino History Society is doing a special presentation on the history of the Cupertino Veterans Memorial, which they're doing on Tuesday, November 26th, right at Quinlan Center on the other side of these lakes. And I'll leave that here also. Many of you have asked about the story of how it got started. It's kind of a lengthy story. So if you're interested in that, I would ask you to come visit us. There's an interview with both Donna and Corky, which actually I do, which our cable TV station produced, and I think you'll find it very informative. I want to thank you all for coming. We're going to end our program with a very moving words by our Navy pastor, Diana Brady, who's been with us since 2007 and does such a wonderful job. When she is through, our soloist will be singing a beautiful song. And then we have a young man from my alma mater, Fremont High School, Charles Depew, who is going to play taps, and I haven't met him yet, so I'm assuming Charles is here, yes. He will be playing taps, and then right after taps, there'll be the retirement of the colors. So that will just flow one to the other. At the end of that ceremony, there are long-stem carnations on all of these benches here. Those are our gift to you to please take them and place them wherever it is appropriate and special for you on our memorial. I'm going to ask Diana Brady to please come forward and start us.
Let us now be in the spirit of prayer. Almighty and loving God, on this day we honor and remember the service and sacrifice of all of our veterans and first responders. We honor especially today the women of our community who've answered the call to serve our country, leaving behind children, husbands, parents, and siblings in order to serve a purpose greater than their own and on behalf of all the people they love, choosing to defend freedom and their loved ones despite the cost. Lord of all the nations, you created us in your image, male and female. You made us to be strong, courageous, and noble of purpose. You've placed in our hearts the desire to contribute to the greater good for all. You've shown us, in the example of your beloved Son, the mind that we are called to imitate, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God as something to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant. And today we thank you for the women who have, throughout all times of war and conflict, profoundly given of themselves in service to the greater good of our people and our country, knowing the cost of freedom and making personal sacrifice for the cause of liberty. And God, we also honor those women who stand and wait, the wives, fiancées, mothers, sisters, and daughters, for they also serve as they sacrifice precious and irreplaceable time with the servicemen and women they love, bearing steadfastly the burden of their absence and the consequences of lives wounded and changed by war. Lord, we pray for the healing of the nations, that the time of war and turmoil might cease. The world is not the way you have intended it to be. As we gather today to honor our veterans, we are all acutely aware that our nation is at war, and that many thousands of young men and women are even now serving in harm's way. Many of our own sons and daughters, wives and husbands, family members and friends are far from home and long more than we can ever know for that day when the nation will be at peace. We are mindful that war brings with it both global and personal suffering, grief and loss. And so we here together pray for your promised day of peace to come upon the earth. And we pray for healing, O God, within the lives of our military community and their families, and ask that you would restore for them the life that you intend for us all. We pray especially for those service women whose trust was betrayed, suffering in the midst of their service at the hands of their brothers in arms. We pray for their healing, for your reassuring balm to heal their wounds and peace beyond our own understanding that only you can give. Help us never to forget what has been given. Be our ever sure defense, and help us to trust that all things work together for good, though we may not be able to see it now. Be our ever-present light in the darkness, and our rock in the midst of every storm. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Amen. So be it.
Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith, hope, light. And
order.
Our band has asked to play a little bit for us while you get your flowers and visit the memorial and say your hellos and goodbyes. Aren't they wonderful? Thank you.